building houses right now? Is that what you're doing?
Yeah, doing a lot of stuff. I work for a repair company. Is a friend of mine from like 15 years ago. He's just always been around in the community fixing things for people who need it. It's almost been kind of like a ministry of his. In fact, while I was gone about a week ago, my house got hit with a windstorm, and he and the company just went to my house and fixed everything.
That's cool.
We're finishing up now, actually framing a whole house.
You showed me a picture of the house that you were framing with a cool view in the background too. So
yeah.
There's something satisfying about working with your hands. At least, you know, I've been finishing my basement, and those are some of my happiest moments is when I'm just down there. Sometimes I'll go to bed at night and I'll lay there thinking of the things I got done and going through each stage of what I did that day in my head. And it gives me this warm fuzzy. And it seems like a lot of our jobs these days we're not actually tangibly creating things or repairing things. And so there's something, I think something beautiful about that.
Yeah. It's been therapy for me for sure. Mm-hmm.
Well, technically the name of the chapter by Peterson is Enemies. It's talking about anger. He opens up with an interesting quote. God is the primary subject in the Psalms, but enemies are established in a solid second place. And so isn't it weird that the book of prayer talks about enemies almost as much as it talks about God?
Well, I mean, humans are so volatile. I mean, like, if you think, it's easy to think of conversations where you've had with like people that you love very, very much. And all it takes is one wrong word for it to become an argument.
Yeah, it's weird how quick we are to explode at each other. And then we're like, where did that come from? Why is the line so thin between us acting civilized and us acting like complete barbarians?
Like for me, I'm just a sensitive person. And then I noticed, I think in myself, that whenever my character is questioned, I become volatile.
It's our buttons, when they get pushed, it's like those are maybe the areas that we self-question or something. And we don't need somebody doing that. I had a job. I got out of ministry for about 7 years before I worked at the church that worked at together. And he was a Christian. And so he would have us pray before our staff meetings. And we were particularly concerned about one of our competitors. And he, I'll never forget, he prayed, he asked God to smite our competition. And I was just like, wow. One of the guys that was worked there too, he had like, I think he had a Quaker background, but he just sort of like, he kind of opened one eye and peeked at me like, did you hear that? And he just was like so stunned that his
butt. I'm praying for your enemies, right?
Yeah.
Is that not what it means?
Praying against your enemies, maybe not praying for your enemies. It's just
praying at them.
It's just a couple letter difference. Yeah, praying at them while you're shooting at them. Whatever. It seems like when a war breaks out, suddenly everything, people figure, hey, it's out of bounds time. You know, maybe one of our themes here is, what do we do with our anger? And movies like The Purge say, repress it for 364 days out of the year. And then on Purge Day, you just go crazy and then you're good the rest of the time. Well, let's read like the controversial Psalm. He prefaces it pretty well. He talks about the Psalm, and we'll read it here in a second. He says, this is raw hate. Nothing in the preceding lines of Psalm 137 has prepared us for this. And he's talking about what we'll get to at the end. This is a can of black spray paint defacing a memorial in white marble. Who let this in our prayer book? And hadn't we better get it out? A lot of people think so. In edition after edition of prayer books, hymn books, and worship books that are based on the Psalms, we find this stanza excised. These psalmectomies are well-intentioned, no doubt, but wrong-headed all the same. So we're going to read a psalm that sounds kind of cool and poetic at first, and then it just like goes
berserk. By the waters of Babylon, there we sat down and wept when we remembered Zion. On the willows there we hung up our lives, for there our captors required of us songs, and our tormentors mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? If I forget you, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget its skill. Let my tongue stick to the roof of my mouth if I do not remember you, if I do not set Jerusalem above my highest joy.
And these citizens of Zion or Jerusalem have been exiled into Babylon. And at some point they find out that their city is completely destroyed and they're just devastated. And they've seen a lot of people killed in the process of losing their homeland, including women and children. And now they're stuck in this desert called Babylon, modern day Iraq, living by some river. What does it mean to have people mocking you and telling you to sing a song that is completely contrary to what's going on?
Talking about those moments where they're saying, play Freebird. Oh, shoot. I mean, I have a song I wrote a long time ago when I was 21. And it's a song about like a really, really hard breakup. And it seems like I can't have a guitar around people who know that song without them saying, hey, play that song. It's a song called Kentucky Home. They're like, play Kentucky Home. I'm like, you want me to relive that? That's what you want?
Interesting.
Tell us the story of when you were really sad again.
I like the way they're hanging their lyres on the willows. And it's like, we're not going to play our instruments. We're going to just store them. Here's a nice little guitar.
All I know to do is call your name. And I know you'll come running just the same, with affection so mysterious and wild, like you did when I was just a simple